electroshocked rats, salivating dogs, and human learning? If this doesn't ring a bell, well, then maybe this short discourse on behaviorism, a learning paradigm from the last century, may elucidate the connection. The behaviorist research program ran from the 1920s to the 1960s. Its core belief can be well exemplified by this quote of Burgess Skinner: "Give me a child and I will shape it into everything." Meaning, we humans come to the world as an empty slate, a tabula rasa. By applying the appropriate learning plans or schedules of reinforcement, we can shape the child's mind to become whatever we wish it to become. An artist, the next president, or even a low-life criminal. Behaviorism states that learning can be understood as an interaction of the learner and its environment. As behaviorism came up during a time when positivism was a dominant mode of scientific inquiry, behaviorists neglect any kind of internal processes, thoughts, insights, problem solving, and so on. Inspired by the then famous Vienna Circle, behaviorists wanted to omit all data that could not be measured directly, that could not be operationalized. So the only data that behaviorists looked at were stimuli coming from the environment, the experimenter or instructor, and the behaviors, responses by the learner. And with the right use of reward and punishment, you could shape the learning of the subject as you please. The two main behaviorist learning mechanisms are classical and operant conditioning. In classical conditioning, you use a neutral stimulus, for example, the ringing of a bell, and couple it with a stimuli, here, tasty dog food, that naturally elicit an involuntary behavior, such as salivating in dogs. And if you do this continuously, after a while, the formally neutral stimulus, the ringing of a bell, alone will elicit the salivation of the dog. Operant conditioning is a training program that intends to shape voluntary behavior by reward and punishment contingencies. The learner receives cues before and after an action and links those again with rewards and punishments, resulting into complex patterns of behavior, such as finding the way out of a maze or reacting to different light stimuli with specific responses. You can already see here, as behaviorists neglect thoughts and higher thinking processes, that they primarily used mammals, rodents, and birds as models for learning. They thought that learning via the animal model would be sufficient to understand learning, not only in animals, but also in humans. In short, learning can be understood as the forming of stimulus-response patterns. Now let's try to evaluate the behaviorist research program. Well, is it enough to study learning on the animal model alone? It kind of is, but then again, it's not. For specific types of learning mechanisms, such as affective and involuntary learning, this may be enough. But anything that involves higher cognition, problem solving, motivated or goal-oriented behavior, this approach is clearly missing crucial variables. Furthermore, the result that reinforcements must be temporally and causally close, so contingent, in the words of a behaviorist, and also consistently applied, still holds true, albeit only for this kind of learning. A core belief of behaviorists was that you could pair any stimulus with any response. And this was the beginning of the end for behaviorism, because studies came up that could show that this clearly is not the case. Not in animals and neither in humans. Moreover, the notion of the human mind as a tabula rasa can also be seen as refuted. We come to the world prepared by evolution, and we do not have to learn every skill via trial and error or via reward and punishment. Lastly, on the radical positivist stance of behaviorists, well, you can have this perspective on the mind, but time has shown that this is not a very fruitful heuristic for the research enterprise. So how are behaviorist theories still relevant for teaching? For example, if you want to use micro-incentives or gamification approaches in your lectures to extrinsically motivate students, then behaviorist schedules of reinforcement can inform your teaching interventions. Also, you have to take into account behaviorist theories when it comes to involuntary, affective, or emotional learning. For example, in settings of exams, students sometimes can develop anxiety towards exams and assessments, even more so if they have experienced failures in their past. Furthermore, you can shape basic behavior patterns and habits. For example, you can reward students that come to your class on time or that pose good questions in your lecture. And you can punish students that come in late or that do not hand in their exercises as promised. And lastly, behaviorists highly emphasize the role of rehearsal and repetition, as it is necessary to form stable behavior patterns. Moreover, they emphasize also the quality and clarity of instruction. Only then the learner has the right cues to know what behavior is then being reinforced and what not. I hope I could show that behaviorist theories still matter for learning, even if not for the whole spectrum of human learning. If you now intend on implementing a behaviorist instructional scheme in one of your lectures, get in touch with us and we can discuss the best way of doing this. Take care and so long.